Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. You've joined the webinar on Peer-to-Peer 101. It's 10 o'clock straight up, and I'm going to get started. I know everybody's got busy days ahead. And good morning to those of you calling in from the West Coast, and good afternoon to those of you on the East Coast. There it is. Okay. Who I am. My name is Vickie Lobello. I am the lead strategist for Turnkey and your speaker for today. Tell you a bit about my background. Most of my background is in the nonprofit sector. Spent almost 20 years with American Cancer Society in the California division, working on every type of fundraiser you can imagine, from duck regatta to jail and bail, and of course, ultimately landing at Relay for Life and helping to grow that program to a $33 million property for the American Cancer Society. I also spent a couple of years with the St. Baldrick's Foundation as their chief development officer and got to work more deeply in major gifts and all other types of fundraising strategies beyond peer-to-peer. So as you can see from my background, I have done things similar to everyone on the phone. I started my career in the nonprofit sector as an events person. And no matter what level of an organization you're at, as an events person, you touch all levels of the organization and you do events. So today's agenda, we're going to go over what is peer-to-peer, how to grow your revenue, where to begin, types of events and activities you can consider as you're embarking on your peer-to-peer if your organization hasn't already chosen one, and we'll leave time at the end for question and answer. Get the housekeeping out of the way. You'll be sent an email with the webinar recording, and please feel free to ask questions. You have your chat available, and we will have Q&A at the end of the webinar. So we're going to start with the very basics. What is peer-to-peer? And I'll give you what I think is a very compelling and simple answer. Peer-to-peer is empowering others to ask on your behalf. So empowering your constituents, your customers, your donors to ask other people to get involved with your mission. And we're going to do a small poll here. And if those of you who are at a computer can answer, that would be great. So the first question is, my organization does peer-to-peer fundraising. And the next question is, how much does your organization raise in peer-to-peer fundraising? Just to help me get a sense of where you guys are coming from. Give that a couple minutes. Okay, so we have a mixed group. Many of you are already doing peer-to-peer, and some of you are not. We'll end the polling and move on. So the other overview on peer-to-peer is, sorry, I always get a phone call when I'm on a call. The many benefits of peer-to-peer include empowering others. So anytime an individual gets involved with your organization and does something for the organization, whether that is getting the word out on advocacy or asking people to get involved in fundraising, the more empowered they are, generally, the more engaged they are with the organization. As they are empowered and engage others, you grow your network and, of course, maximize your fundraising. So this is a recent view of types of things. So on the far left, you'll see traditional peer-to-peer, runs, walks, biking events, endurance, and fundraising. In the middle is, and to the right, is the changing sector of fundraising for DIY. Of course, memorial tributes and giving days are pretty standard. And then, of course, project-based funding and crowdfunding. All of these things can sometimes fall into peer-to-peer, and I'll cite memorials and tributes. Some organizations utilize memorials and tributes as a direct donation strategy, and some use peer-to-peer, allowing people to ask others on behalf of the organization to get involved or donate to a memorial. It varies by organization. So crowdfunding versus peer-to-peer. Crowdfunding is when you ask people just to make a straight donation. So they're not engaging their network, they are making a donation. And this historically has been a very successful way for organizations, both large and small, to raise funds for your nonprofit. Peer-to-peer, as you can see, exponentially expands your reach, both on revenue and on participation, and often is connected to fundraising pages or ways that you can understand both who's donating and participating in your event. So the growing success of peer-to-peer. 568 at the left is the average fundraiser raises that much from seven donors. Seven donors. I continue to be amazed by this. It is a large amount of money from just a few amount of constituents. So those of you who have participants that say, oh, I don't know that many people. Do you know five people? Do you know seven people? Very achievable. Nearly one third of all online donations are now made through peer-to-peer, meaning this is not only one of the largest ways for nonprofits to raise money, it is one of the continuing growing phases or large ways to raise money. And then of course, social fundraising, along with other benefits of peer-to-peer fundraising. Peer-to-peer appeals to many. I get this question from clients quite a lot. Is peer-to-peer a boomer type of activity? Is it more attractive to those? And there have been some recent studies out, as you can see the numbers on your screen, that show Gen X and millennials and older generations than boomers really are attracted to peer-to-peer. There are a number of reasons for this that we'll go into more deeply, but one of the reasons is connecting with others around a cause and feeling like you're part of something bigger than yourself. And I'll relate to that again, but this is something really powerful for your organization that while direct donation can help you connect to an organization, when you're engaged in an activity or the type of thing that many people are rallying around a cause at a certain point in time, it changes how people engage in a very real way. Biggest fundraising challenges among nonprofit organizations. So this is a list that is that has been out there for a while and doesn't seem to be shifting much. Finding likely contributors, deepening relationships, standing out from other nonprofits. All these things are something those of us in the nonprofit sector face on a day-to-day basis, and there's significant challenges around fundraising, both the people and the revenue, and how to go about getting more of that for your organization. So let's talk about growing your revenue. Whoops, sorry, went too fast. Okay. Start about with the basic industry performers. Hopefully those of you on the line have seen some of the statistics around what types of activities. This is classic activities, cycle, endurance, 5K, and walk, and how they're doing at raising money for organizations. Walk continues to be the highest performer as an aggregate. Part of this is more organizations do walk than anything else. We'll go a little bit deeper into the others. I'd say cycle and endurance, and you may already know this, have a higher average per participant and gives you access to, in some situations, a more affluent audience, whereas walk is appealing to many and has a low barrier to entry, meaning anybody can do it. Even folks that have challenges can be a part of walk and engage in that way. These are some statistics from DIY. This is a growing sector within growing revenue stream within nonprofits. And as you can see, the largest still on record is Movember at over 17 million. for those of you who may or may not be familiar with Movember, it is all virtual, all the way. No physical events as part of Movember, and very attractive. Their primary audience, as I understand it, is a millennial audience. But there's some others that are raising significant revenue through DIY or virtual fundraising. And just to give you a basic understanding, DIY in some cases is you make up your own fundraiser. In others, like Movember, it is a certain time of the year and a certain type of fundraiser, but it's all done virtual. So nothing is hosted necessarily by the organization. Constituents come to the organization through generally an online portal and start raising funds as part of that. The power of this, especially in today's day and age, is really around the fact that people can rally around a topic without necessarily having to be completely tied to a certain date on the calendar. As you can see, Longest Day, which is Alzheimer's, and Team Fox and Team World Vision are doing very well with their peer-to-peer fundraising as well under do-it-yourself. Movember is activity and time of year. Some of these others have a specific activity or a specific time of year. Most of them aren't generic in both categories. And this is a way to rally the crowd, your audience, whatever a crowd means to you, around a topic, because certain times of year gives you the opportunity to market to and message to your audience in a way that can bring them to the table. That sense of urgency is incredibly important no matter what type of peer-to-peer activity or event that you're going to do. So let's talk about individual giving. So this is your basic giving pyramid, acquisition at the lower end, which is at the bottom of the pyramid, which is usually where peer-to-peer comes in. It is a great way to acquire new participants and new donors to your organization, and then on up the line. Peer-to-peer fundraising feeds all levels of the pyramid. I'll use an example in a little bit that better illustrates that every single one of these levels, at some point, your peer-to-peer donors or fundraisers will enter into the organization. And I'd say one of the many benefits of peer-to-peer is the fact that the larger the bottom of your pyramid is more people at the donor or participant later level that are evangelizing for your organization. The larger that audience is, the more people you have to acquire for all the different levels of fundraising for your organization. So distinguished giving, and distinguished meaning major giving, and I'll relate back to an experience I had with St. Baldrick's. St. Baldrick's, at the time that I entered the organization, had not achieved a distinguished gift or a major gift. And when I say major gift, at that point, we were measuring that at 10,000 or above. They were a pure peer-to-peer audience. And while they had achieved $10,000 gifts, let me clarify, none of them were given just in a distinguished giving kind of way. They were all given through their events. One of my goals as I entered the organization was to explore and attain major gifts through their peer-to-peer audience, participants and donors. And this is a pure microcosm of what can happen when you have a peer-to-peer audience. At that point, I was able to work with some really smart people and wonderful parents and individuals within the organization. And within our first year, I should give you a little more context, St. Baldrick's raises $33 million from head shaving events. Within our first year, we were able to attain our first million in major gifts for the organization. I believe this further illustrates the fact that even though folks may enter an organization as a peer-to-peer donor or fundraiser at a fairly low level, their capabilities and the fact that you have access to both their passion and their interest in the organization gives you the opportunity to build a relationship, which will at some point achieve a major gift. Awareness. I think everybody on the phone knows this, but it bears mentioning. Anytime you put on an activity, virtual or otherwise, that allows the community or people to gather around your cause, your organization, it achieves a different level of awareness. It is marketing, but it is also that experience that allows people to interact with folks within your organization in a really meaningful way and creates passionate advocates. And I'll relate back to my experience with Relay for Life, and I don't know how many of you have engaged in or aware of Relay for Life, but the early years of Relay were incredibly magical due to the fact that people would experience the event and then want to bring all of their friends and family along with them to the next year. And this wasn't because we were spending a lot of money around creating an event experience that was a Disney experience. It was really about the community getting together and rallying around the cause. Social influence. So you may or may not have experienced this with your organization. So according to Black Dot data, direct response, and this is just email, equals 0.1% of people saying yes. So that means for you to get donations through direct response through email, you need a fairly large list of folks that you're engaging with in order to raise money. By comparison, in peer-to-peer, 25% say yes. Let's talk about why that is. I'm sure many of you, like I do, have neighborhood kids or adults even knocking on your door asking you to donate to their band or their soccer club or whatever it is that they are raising funds for. It's really hard to say no to somebody you know. I rarely say no to somebody I know, and it is a real challenge because I know a few people, and making sure I'm saying yes to a large number of people and still making sure I'm supporting them. But the power of somebody asking you to raise money or to donate to an organization is incredible and very difficult to measure. When your neighborhood kid rings your doorbell, it's difficult to say no to her. Why is that? There are hundreds of great organizations to give to. So why them? It's because the connection you have to the person, not the organization. Well, it's good to support the band, the youth group. It's your neighbor you're saying yes to, not necessarily the organization. When you are trying to acquire supporters, peer-to-peer is your best foot in the door. And that's not to say that your organizations are doing great work. And some people will come to your organizations because of the great work that they're doing, but they're more likely to come to the organization if somebody they know asks them to get involved in some way or another. Building your audience. So as you start to bring people in, let's say they're a donor to your peer-to-peer event, they may have no affinity with the organization and be completely unaware of what you do and what your emphasis is, whether or not you're funding research or what types of things that you're supporting. As you can see, this is the upside down pyramid, but the level of affinity in a perfect world that we would want is hero. For all of our constituents. And that's because the more engaged they are, the more of an ambassador they are for our organization. This pyramid works the same in peer-to-peer as it does through mission work. We really want people out there that are evangelizing or being a hero and sharing all the great work of the organization, but also recruiting people in their day-to-day lives, in their communities, wherever they go. This is important to growing your audience, to bringing in people that have no affinity and are unaware and moving them down the levels of the pyramid. Some people may not move all the way down to hero. Some will stay in these upper levels, and that's okay if they continue to donate and that kind of thing. I see that as an opportunity, helping them to understand the organization better. I'll use an example from St. Baldrick's. It was interesting to me, we'd get people that would call and said, I just got a charge to my credit card for St. Baldrick's and I don't know who you are. And the question my staff would ask them is, do you know somebody who recently shaved their head to help childhood cancer support? And they said, yes. And they said, that was because of that. So not only were they unaware of the organization and what the great work the organization was doing, they didn't even know the name of the organization. But through time and patience and great communication, we were able to build on that affinity. Where to begin? So that's a lot of overarching information. If you're deciding to launch a peer-to-peer program or go more deeply into one, where do you begin? You need to ask yourself a lot of questions. What kind of event? What kind of participant? Where are your folks coming from? And when you look at your file of folks, how are they engaging currently? And how would you like them to engage? What walks of life do they come from? Are they primarily medical field, or are they just your average folks, or are they folks that are affected by a specific disease or challenge? What results are you looking for? If revenue is your number one outcome that you want to measure, keep that as your North Star, guiding you along the way of what you want to achieve. And how will you find staff time to support the effort? This is often a challenge, and we'll talk about this a little bit further on. I haven't met or worked with a nonprofit yet that had staff that were just looking for things to do. My experience in the nonprofit sector, in the very, very early years, we had like 1 month a year where we could clean out files and that kind of thing. And then as years progressed, there was really never a downtime. We went from one busy day to the next, and not just busy. I like the term drinking from the fire hose. It's very challenging to find time for new initiatives or programs when every day you're just trying to keep your head above water. So we're going to talk about MD Anderson. If you haven't heard of it, they recently did a boot walk last year. And we had the privilege and honor of working with MD Anderson on this event. We came in early on, and the board was starting to talk about having a retail attractive event, a bike ride or run, that type of thing. And we were able to work with their folks and identify the types of things, help them through the decision-making process, which ultimately the decision they made was to do a boot walk. And the other things that we decided along the way are the core principles or tenets, that it would be a fundraising event, the North Star, as I mentioned earlier, that it would be volunteer-driven, inclusive to everybody, transparent and not for sale. I'll mention not for sale because this is a tough decision for those of you putting on events on a regular basis. Having people set up booths or give product and that kind of thing can be very attractive as you're putting on an event. The not for sale is a very challenging thing that you need to work through on a not day-to-day basis. I encourage you to consider it if you are building a new peer-to-peer event. It does help people to understand that they need to change their level of engagement. And I'll use Relay as an example on this one. Relay was not for sale, and I don't know where it is now. I've been away for a couple of years, but we did not allow people to come and set up booths and pay us $100 to have a booth at the event. But what we did allow is that they could form a team and hopefully hit the minimum fundraising. And as part of that, they could talk about what their organization did, but they needed to be part of the event, not necessarily somebody donating a lump sum just to come and solicit to the people who would be at the event. Next list of questions, MD Anderson had to go through, reg fee or not, how do we motivate people, how do we get them to fundraise, how are we going to staff this thing, and what will all that staff cost? So I don't know how many of you are familiar with Dunbar's number, Robin Dunbar, a scientist. So at the far end of the sector, the number five, that's the number of relationships you have that should you unfortunately end up in an emergency room. Generally, that's the number of people that you would call. The 1500 at the other end of the spectrum is people whose faces you see or names you see that you could recall the face relative to it. And I hope many of you on the phone are able to do that. 1500 is a high number for me. I'm not sure I could meet that test for Robin Dunbar. 150, the number at the direct center of this graph, that's the number of people that should you have the financial resources to do so, that you would invite to a party at your house. And that's the number of people that are most likely to attend or do something. in the peer-to-peer world, 150 is a magical number, because when you bring in a new participant, somebody that is engaged with your organization, or more importantly, a new committee member, 150 contacts are the folks that are most likely to say yes to doing something. Either they'll share the information about the event, they'll donate to it, or they'll participate in it. And that helps you to see how important new committee members and new leadership is to your event. That is how you grow. One person can equal 150. In many cases, to be fair, the acquisition number isn't the full 150. It's a much lower number, but it is a good number to work with regard to outreach and acquisition for your event. So, number of relationships. So now let's do the math. In MD Anderson, this is how we worked with them to do goal setting. We said, okay, we've got 150 at the center of Dunbar's number, and we figured out that they wanted to have a very large event. So we said, you need 94 people on your community, on your committee, putting this on. And remember, this is MD Anderson, a very large organization. This math is scalable no matter what size your organization is. So 150 times 94 equals 14,000 hooks in the community. Well, as I mentioned previously, all 14,000 of those individuals won't necessarily participate or engage in the event. But we said, okay, let's say 3% of that. That seems realistic as a conversion rate out of the 14,000. That would mean 423 team captains. A nice number. And at the end of it, the math worked. MD Anderson was able to get 94 people on their committee. Many of those folks were not involved in logistics, of course. As you can imagine, they had a company that was handling most of the logistics. The primary reason for building out a committee of that size was to ensure that they had those hooks into the community, and that those people that were serving on the committee were able to help bring people to the event, especially in a new event. This is really wonderful results for a first year event, and I think the most pure microcosm that illustrates the fact that volunteer leadership can make a huge impact on your fundraising totals. So let's talk about types of events and activities. You want to look for a mission match, and I'm referencing here the Pancakes for Parkinson's from Team Fox, creating step-by-step guides, sharing success stories, creating handbooks for navigation of your platform, and then, of course, if you have the staff resources, providing assistance. Now, this is Pancakes for Parkinson's is a DIY activity and would not require the same type of staff support as a physical activity. And it also varies on how much assistance is offered. Some organizations launch a do-it-yourself or DIY activity and provide almost no staff support for their constituents, and people will figure it out. Some people will figure it out, some won't. There's some great things happening in the, what I call the outside the box category. Don't know if you're familiar with Shower Strike, but literally asking people to stop taking showers until they raise the number of, the amount of funds that they set their goal at. This is very different than your classic walk or run and has a fun component, but it is really a mission match to this organization. Let's talk about staffing and peer-to-peer support. So I'm going to talk about two different models. Of course, there are many variations on theme within the spectrum. So physical support. Many organizations have one staff person that supports $250,000 worth of revenue. Typically on physical support, the staff are boots on the ground, meaning they're centrally located to where the events are taking place, and active recruitment. And, you know, one of the examples I can give you on this is, of course, American Cancer Society. In the early days, one staff person for five or six events, but later on it was one person for about $250,000 in revenue. The number of events varied based on how successful those events were. And I mention active recruitment because when you have somebody that is boots on the ground as a staff person, it is possible, reasonable, and expected that they be a member of the committee and out there in the community recruiting new people to your event or activity. And virtual support. So St. Baldrick's, at the time that I was with the organization, each staff person supported about 100 events. This is a very different model. So I left American Cancer Society, went into St. Baldrick's, and ACS was very much physical events, that type of thing. This model is a great model. All the staff were housed in Monrovia, California. I'm in California. And we're able to provide virtual support to these events. The events were incredibly volunteer-driven, less than 1% of the events ever met a staff person physically in a one-year cycle. So very, very different model. Higher degree of marketing support and more reactionary. So should you choose to move in this type of a staffing model, know that volume, whenever your time of year, when your event is taking place, is very high in a reactionary phase. So St. Baldrick's, about 80%, 90% of their events took place in March. March was a very busy time at the organization. And we provided a good degree of marketing support for the events to help them get the word out. Can technology help you? The answer is yes, of course. 141% average fundraising per participant compared to industry average, 38% $0 fundraisers, and 954%, is the average of return on investment for peer-to-peer. So technology in the current state, ways to outreach to your participants and help them to raise more money, recognizing them for the things that they do and get them more involved, can really help your performance go up significantly. Using that technology, I always tell people I am the lead strategist with Turnkey. You start with the strategy first and then go down to the tactics. So identifying what behaviors you want, what's important to you and your organization, and then moving them, using your technology to help move people in that direction. So, recipe for success in peer-to-peer. If you want revenue, if that's your number one thing, A equals awareness. Awareness and authenticity. And you need a lot of awareness and connections. And then you've got to pull all this together to make sure that you're doing a great peer-to-peer fundraiser. So summing up some things, obviously peer-to-peer major gifts can come out of your peer-to-peer. You want to look at, yes, I'll go over the formula again. Seem to have lost it in my notes though. So my apologies. So the point of the formula is making sure that you're looking at your reach, and I'll send you the notes afterwards. It seems to be missing from my note deck. My apologies. Looking at your authenticity and your messages, and then of course your audience, and then building an experience and engagement that will keep people engaged with your organization. So, sorry, we'll get back to that soon. Or I'll send it to everybody afterwards. Summing it up, major gifts, always look for a mission match. Whenever possible, that emotional experience that matches your mission, that gives people a sense of who you are and what you're doing. I recommend strongly that you consider low barrier to entry. Walk and virtual are exploding, virtual especially, because anybody can do it anywhere, anytime. And that means that you have the opportunity to bring more people to your organization. Staff and volunteer driven is a continuum. Many people in the industry use, it's either all staff or all volunteer driven. even in the example that I gave with St. Baldrick's in a volunteer-driven experience, there were still staff involved. So there's still a staff component, even in a highly volunteer-driven component. Or, as I mentioned, with some organizations that do DIY that is completely volunteer or constituent-driven, meaning there are resources available, but not really staff support or guidance as part of that. I recommend, if it's possible, to think outside the box. While walks continue to be incredibly successful and bring in millions upon millions of dollars for organizations, differentiating yourself in some way, whether it's with a walk or outside of a walk, can really help people be attracted to your organization. You're going to need to consider investment. I would be not doing my job if I didn't mention to you the fact that any of these activities require investment of human investment, staff time, and financial investment. Most events take some time to get started, and while having a great idea and a great website will help, similar to pure DIY, just building a website will not mean that you'll be successful. You need to invest in acquisition and getting the word out and marketing and messaging. And then, of course, as I think the presentation has offered, there are many paths to success. There are many ways to go about doing this. And if you're new to peer-to-peer, there are so many decisions to make along the way. I encourage you either to consider consulting or to work with somebody who has made those decisions along the way. It's somewhat surprising, even as I walked very quickly through the MD Anderson engagement, how many decisions, especially the tenants at the top of the decision tree, but then on down below that, that have to be made, which include, you know, materials and brand and all those other things. So it is worthy of the effort, but it does require an investment. So for those of you who are familiar with us, you may be aware that Katrina and Otis have written a book around this very topic. It's called The Dollar Dash. It is a really good read, and I say that because I've enjoyed it myself. It talks about why incentives don't work, and gifts can be demotivating. So many people in the industry still think that if you're able to give a $100 gift card to somebody who raises $100, that will turbocharge your fundraising. And while it may aid your fundraising in the first year, anytime it's something that can be valued in the marketplace, it will hurt you in the long run with regard to long-term outcomes for fundraising. It's not all about the mission. As I mentioned earlier in the presentation, it really is about people's connection to one another and working with those individuals to help bring more people to your organization. The mission matters. I am a nonprofit staff person from way back. While I'm not in the nonprofit sector now, I am a true believer that the mission matters, but it isn't all about the mission. And great events don't always equal great money. For those of you who are doing what we call retail attractive events, endurance runs, those sorts of things, that have high retail value in the space, they don't always mean great money, because sometimes the cost associated with bringing in a dollar is significant. So think about the fact of, you know, great events. So retail attractive is often a way to engage your folks that are more affluent. Your average endurance runner tends to be in the upper middle class, which is, you know, something that every organization needs to have access to. And having access to those folks can help you raise great money through other attributes within your organization. However, higher volume will help feed the bottom of the pyramid and make sure that you have plenty of people to work with in many different ways, whether that be through mission or through fundraising or events or other types of activities that you and your organization need to achieve. So we're going to go to Q&A. Before we do that, I have another poll for you. Oh no, sorry. We're doing Q&A now. So for those of you that have questions, if you could put it in the chat box, my apologies on the formula. It changed from my initial presentation. I promised to send it all to you in the exact way it needs to be. So I know I need to clarify that. So my first question is, as a person new to peer-to-peer, how long does it take to launch a peer-to-peer program? That answer can vary. I recommend planning for a one-year launch. Within that time, you would tease up the program and market it, of course, start attaining and acquiring volunteers and build out your volunteer leadership. The MD Anderson engagement, again, while a very large organization, they were able to launch and activate that within a year. The other question I have is, do I recommend an organization having a certain annual revenue amount to participate in peer-to-peer? Example, $5 million. The answer is no. As I mentioned on the Dunbar's number, those numbers are scalable. So even if you have a smaller organization and your desire is to grow the organization, helping people to experience your organization in new ways can really help to grow the organization. Of course, the amount of investment and the expectations out of that event would also scale down as part of the how many people in your audience. And this is something we work with clients on a regular basis, is what could they expect to raise out of peer-to-peer fundraising. Any additional questions before we go to our last poll? Okay. If you would give us some feedback, that would be really helpful. And again, I want to thank everybody for being a part of Peer-to-Peer 101. Hope it was helpful information for you. And feel free to ask additional questions if you have any. Thank you, everybody, and I hope the rest of your day is a good one. I'll leave the polling open for a few more minutes. Thank you.